Good morning, all of you. Students, I would like to introduce Dr. Chitra Shankar. She is a principal scientist at Indian Institute of Rice Research, Hyderabad. A brief bio about her. So she is an entomologist at the Indian Institute of Rice Research under the Indian Council of Agricultural Research. She holds a PhD in agricultural entomology from Tamil Nadu Agricultural University, Coimbatore. She has been with ICAR from 1994 and has worked in various parts of the country. Dr. Chitra Shankar has been working on habitat management strategies to enhance biological control in rice. Her field of specialization is studying the biodiversity of agroecosystems, their functional significance, and utilizing the ecological services provided by this biodiversity. Her aim is enhancing natural control of insect pests in agricultural systems through habitat management and reducing insecticide use. Recently, she has visited Australia on an Endeavour Leadership Program scholarship given by the Government of Australia. She has travelled to Thailand, Malaysia, Singapore and the Philippines for presenting her work and discussions in this field. She has also been observing and studying Odonata associated with rice fields, an ideal ephemeral wetland habitat that supports a number of dragonfly species. And moreover, Ms. Chitra is an avid birder, and that's how I came to know about her activity in research in entomology, and also now she is a budding photographer too. So I hand over this talk to Dr. Chitra Shankar, who will enlighten you all with some beautiful knowledge about insects and their effect on the ecosystem and how insects are vital for the ecosystems to work. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Asifji. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
So Asifji was telling a lot of big words. How many of that did you understand? What is an entomologist? What am I?
An entomologist in the study of insects.
Yes, I study insects, okay? And then he said habitat management. What is this habitat management? So habitat, anything is a habitat. Even this is a habitat, right? So every place there is a habitat. You have some trees, shrubs, water, everything. Then you manage it in such a way that good insects flourish. Here this habitat is being managed in such a way that you all flourish, think and learn. So this is a habitat for you all. Similarly, you have natural habitats, okay? So I am involved with habitat management in rice fields. You all know, right, that we rice crops are being eaten by insects. So he was talking about insecticide use, the number of insecticide sprays that will be used in one single crop of rice. When you have a conducive environment, 17 times it will be sprayed. You will have 17 types of insecticides sprayed into this crop, and then it comes to you. So you can imagine what it has, what impact it has on your health. So what I am working for is to reduce this insecticide use. So in nature, we have insects that manage insects, insects that feed on insects. So I will be enhancing the habitat so that these insects will flourish and the pests will go down. So that is my job. And what is biodiversity? Bio, the diversity of life in any ecosystem, any niche. So that is biodiversity. And each of it has a significance. Just like in our society, each of us, like a mom has some job, dad has some job, we have some job. Like that, all living organisms have niches and they have something with which they work on. So that is what is habitat. Okay? I'm working on that. And some word called ephemeral he used. What is ephemeral?
No idea.
That's why I wanted to ask you these questions before I start.
I have one idea. It's such a big word, it must be a complex scientific term.
Nothing. Ephemeral is something which is very transient, which is not permanent. Forests are permanent, right? Unless we destroy it. Forests are permanent. Ephemeral means agricultural landscapes. So crops last maybe up 30, 60 days, 120 days. So it is ephemeral. There is an insect called mayfly. It's called as Ephemeroptera. Why? Because it lives just for one day. So you know, it exists only for a short time. Ephemeral means it. So I am working with a landscape which is existing for only a small time, and I'm trying to enhance things with it. Forest, yes, it's there for a long time and you can do something with it. But when you're doing with a transient landscape, it is very difficult. So that is what I am doing, okay? And how many people are freaked out by insects?
Me.
Spiders? See, I'm an entomologist. My daughter screams if she sees a spider. So phobias to insects are very common, right? But they have a very important role to play, which is what I'm going to be talking about today. Okay? And I hope I will inspire at least one or two of you to become an entomologist tomorrow. Okay? So today I'm going to be talking about the insect world and the importance of insects in ecosystem functioning. So what I will talk today, see, please don't take notes, just note this or take a photo of this, that's all. Okay, this is the gist of what I'm going to talk, okay. I will talk of what is the biodiversity of insects, some amazing facts about insects. Then I will talk about insects in culture and religion, how it has been viewed. Then insects function as herbivores. You know what is herbivore?
Yes, only plants.
Yeah, so they are the primary consumers. So they feed on the primary producers, right? I have to use the biology terms so that you will be familiar with it, okay? And then insect pollinators, and then insect seed dispersers, and insects as food or providers of food, okay? Insects itself as food or as providers of food, and insects in pest management, which I am working on, and insect as saprophagus, that is detritivores, which feed on decaying matter, and ecosystem engineers. This is the most important part I would like to focus on today. And also, it's not always good, you know, this ecosystem services provided by insects. What is not good is called as ecosystem disservices. So that is a terminology I'm introducing you today. One is ecosystem service, another is ecosystem disservice. Okay, positive, negative. So you all know insects belong to the kingdom Animalia. It's an animal, okay? We are also animals. That insect is also an animal. And then it belongs to the phylum Arthropoda and class Insecta or Hexapoda. Hexa means what? That last person there, I want you to tell me, what is hexa? Anybody there?
Six.
Six, okay? Hexa means six. Hexapoda means? Six legs. They have six legs. That's why it's called hexapoda. Poda means legs. So that is why insects are classified as hexapoda. Okay? And insect body. You know what this number is?
Number of insects.
Yes. At any point of time, scientists estimate that this is the number of insects that exist in the world.
Now,
1 trillion.
How is it calculated?
They have been estimating smaller niches and then they will multiply it. Always it's extrapolation in science, okay? They can't just count every single insect. So they will count, okay, forest habitat will have this much. Then this kind of habitat, urban habitat, will have this much. So they have put together and they have extrapolated and they estimate that there are about 1 trillion. So they are all around you. Okay, you can never be without insects.
They are all. Most of them are mosquitoes.
That's what everybody thinks, but no, it is not like that. Cockroaches, what happened to cockroaches? Yeah. So insects basically have three parts, okay? The head, the thorax, and the abdomen. It's divided into three parts. They have two pairs of wings mostly, which may be reduced to a single pair, and they have three pairs of legs and two antennae. Okay? That is the typical insect for you. So coming to what is the biodiversity of insects, if you see in the whole animal biomass, the arthropods and which are mostly marine, that is arthropods, marine arthropods, arthropoda means what? Arthro means jointed, poda means leg, I told. So even crustacea, your prawns, everything come into this. Okay, anything which has got that jointed legs, all come into this category. So marine arthropods and the terrestrial arthropods, somewhere around 40 to 50% of the total biomass. You see humans, you see how much humans account for Somebody can tell me?
2.5%
only, but these humans are causing so much of problems for everybody. This 2.5% biomass for the whole of the world. Okay? Yeah. Unfortunately, sentient brains are not being used in the proper way. So insects represent a dominant component of biodiversity in most of the terrestrial ecosystems. And if you look at the species richness, this is again I'm representing in kingdom. See, Animalia represent around 80%. Then in Animalia, Arthropoda represents around 80%. And then coming to in Animalia, you have insects alone, that is the subphylum Insecta, that Hexapoda, that again comes around 75 to 78%. And within the insect kingdom, the maximum comes under beetles. You know, have you seen beetles?
Yes.
In your rice, you get it?
Yes.
Yeah, they are hard, they have hard wings and then it is covered like this.
Shells.
Yeah, hard shells. So, the beetles are the maximum even among the insects. So, that is the classification. That is, you have kingdom, you have Animalia, the maximum. Then you have Arthropoda, then Hexapoda and Coleoptera. Okay? So, what is this biodiversity important for? You know, biodiversity at any point of time is very important for ecosystem functioning. And insects are the most diverse. So, for example, she was telling me that there are mosquitoes, more mosquitoes. But what you are aware of is only what is around you. Okay, you might see two species of cockroaches around you and you might think all cockroaches are bad. But you know, there are 4,500 species of cockroaches in the world. And none of them will come, except those two species will come and live in your house. They are all living in forests and they are very important part. They decompose the leaves, the wood, and they return nutrients to the soil. They will never even come to your house even if you ask them to. So it's only those two species of those 4,500 species.
Yeah. Uninvited, yes.
Yeah, are two species are uninvited. But 4,500 minus 2, even if you invite, won't come into your house. They are all good insects. So what I'm trying to say is the diversity is very high. And the good diversity is very high, which we do not see. We see only the pest part of it. Okay. And then one in every five living thing in the world, including plants, microorganisms, is a beetle. That much of biodiversity is there in the world. 20% of the 1.7 billion living organisms that is existing in the world is Hexapoda. Then coming to some facts, because I know you will all ask me, what is the largest insect in the world? So the largest insect is the Goliath beetle. It is around 4.3 inches in. But why you're calling it largest is because of its bulk, its weight, and a lot of other things. It is not the longest though. The longest is the stick insect. If you see, the man is holding a stick insect here. See this? Yes, that is a stick insect. You know, it is 64 inches long, okay? It is a Chinese giant stick insect, that is the longest. And smallest is called a fairy fly. It is actually a parasitoid which parasitizes the eggs of small insects. And it's called, it's only 0.005 inch in size, okay? So you have this range from 0.005 up to 64 inches, you have insects, okay? So this is the diversity of insects. And then, can you tell me how a butterfly feeds or... what does it feed on?
Worms.
Butterfly?
Worms.
No.
Leaves.
Where do you see butterflies sitting on? Where do you see?
Flowers.
Whoever said flowers? Flowers. So what do flowers offer?
Honey.
Yes, honey. So butterflies feed honey. So how do they get to the honey? Because most flowers will have a tube. So how do they get to the honey? They have a straw, you know. Their mouth parts are modified into a straw that you see in the center here. This one is a butterfly thing. So it will roll its proboscis. It's called as proboscis. Just like an elephant has proboscis, it will roll its proboscis. And it is actually a straw. It is not actually a tube, but it is two parts joined together and it forms the straw. And then when it wants to feed, it will stretch it out, push it inside the flower and then suck the nectar. So the insects, you know, That is why they have such great mouth parts, different mouth parts. When you see a housefly on your table, just watch it. So this first one is a housefly. It has got sponging mouth parts. You know what it does? It will put a small thing out and there is a small round thing in the front of it. And it has got lines in it. So what it does is it secretes some saliva and it liquefies the food. And then it is sponged up. So it's called sponging mouth parts. And then you have the biting and chewing mouth parts. A lot of that you might have seen. You might have been bitten by some of the insects too. Then honeybees, you know, they also have, they take honey, but they have got lapping, you know, like the dog, you know, like that. It will lap up the honey. So it's got lapping type of mouth part. And then you have the mosquito. How does it poke you? It's got a needle actually, right? It's made of this, just like proboscis, it's a very thin, long mouth part so that it can get in between your skin holes. Your skin has got holes, right? So it's able to get into the hole. It's got a needle for a mouth part. And that's how they are able to suck your blood. So this kind of different mouth parts, that's why if you see horror movies made of insects, many horror movies have insects in them. Because first it creeps out the people, and second it's got this kind of strange feeding patterns. It is even some of the bugs have got extra oral digestion. Extra oral, just like what I said, is you eat and inside your mouth your digestion is taking place. But in insects it happens outside. It will secrete some fluid outside and it will liquefy the insect, and then it will just suck it up. Because most of the insects will have sucking mouth parts. I will show you photos, then you will be able to see. So in religion and culture, there's always been insects because it's all around us, okay? For some, it is sacred. Like for the Egyptians, the scarab is sacred. Scarab is a type of beetle and their god is depicted with a scarab head. And then in Buddhists, the cicada. Cicada is actually a symbol of good rebirth. And you have, in Hebrew, you have Beelzebub, lot of flies. And then you also have some sayings about go be busy as the bee, go be hardworking as the ant, and stuff like that. So it has always played an important role in culture because it's all around us. We have a number of movies, like I told you, horror movies made out of insects. So bee movie, then you have, but most of them, even we have our own Iga. Okay, but actually they all distort the facts a little bit just to make the story. It's not real. Nothing can be like whatever is shown in these movies. It's not real. They have just, you know, extrapolated some facts and skewed some facts, and they have made them into horror movies. So we have a number of movies which are based on the phobia for insects and the creeping quality of insects. We have a number of movies. Insects also have played an important part in economy. You know sericulture, what is sericulture? It is the growing of silk worms. You know the silk,
yes.
What you wear, you know, that comes from pattu, that comes from an insect.
Yes.
That insect spins a cocoon and then the outer covering silk is being spun out, and that is how your silk comes. You know, it takes around a million cocoons to make one sari. That you should also remember that. So what happened was, in early days when silk was produced in Japan and China, it opened out the trade routes all across the world just for the silk. So that is how insects have played a role even in opening out economy and joining countries together. So this is the silk route. Nowadays even you have tourism for following the silk route actually. Then coming to the first one, insects which function as herbivores. So when you do gardening, you will know that some of your plants are being eaten by insects, right? So you think it is bad?
Yes.
It is bad if you have a plant at home, you're wanting to grow, and if it is eaten by this insect, it is bad. But in natural ecosystems, like in a forest, you have some trees, you have some shrubs, you have some creepers. So these kind of herbivores, they prune plants. They let the light in. For example, you think of Amazonian forests, where there is a very thick growth of trees and shrubs and undergrowth. How does the light get in to the understory? So this kind of pruning helps for keeping the growth in control and to trigger new growth and to return nutrients to the soil. So in a natural ecosystem, you know, agricultural landscapes are not natural ecosystems. You won't see in nature rice being grown for hectares and hectares, acres and acres, right? You won't see a single crop. You will see a few different tree species, you will see different shrubs, you will see different creepers. So many things constitute the ecosystem. But whereas man, he wants only rice, he wants only wheat. So he grows acres and acres of the same crop. That is why the pests are increasing and we are not able to manage it. But in a natural ecosystem, they are also keeping those things under control. The plants are controlled by herbivores, the herbivores are controlled by the next level of the trophic system. We have a whole ecosystem functioning there. Our machine is running without you knowing. It is like that in a natural ecosystem. So I would like to give one example. This is the leaf cutter ant, okay, Atta. So yeah, there are two species. These leaf cutter ants are seen in Amazonian forest. You might, if you watch National Geographic, you might have watched a video of this. So what it does is, this is, what do you think it's doing with the leaf? It's cutting the leaf and it's carrying the leaf and going. What do you think it's doing with the leaf? They are fungus farmers. What they do is they take these leaves and take it to their homes, and then they crush it, and then they introduce a microorganism into it which helps some fungus grow. That fungus is eaten by the ant. So they are practically farmers, actually. And how they are cutting it? So the trees are very tall, okay? They'll go in a line up there, and then they'll use their mandibles and they're cutting the leaf. Then how do they get down? You know, when they cut the leaf, it's so big, they can't just carry it down. You know, they just drop down and the leaf acts as a parachute and it just comes to the surface and then they start walking. So, and then they'll all carry it home. And this is one way in America, this Amazonian forest, to reduce the growth and increase the light penetration. They play a very important role here. So herbivores play an important role in managing the upper canopy level. They are managing the leaves so that they become reduced and the light gets down and other plants can grow. So that is how, this is what I would like to show about a herbivore. Then there is a very interesting thing. So this cotton crop, you know, no? This cotton comes from a crop, your
yes.
Cotton. So cotton crop is grown in south of USA. And in south of USA, it was devastated by a weevil, a boll weevil. See, cottons come as a boll, okay? First, it comes as a boll. It's called as a boll. Then it will break open and you will see the lint inside. The lint is attached to seeds. That is what we take and make it into thread and clothes. So this weevil was damaging it like crazy. And they were not able to grow the crop at all. But what happened was, because they were so dependent on cotton, they suddenly, because of this weevil, they shifted to other crops. And then their economy grew. They were so thankful to this weevil, which, you know, taught them that single crop is not good, that they should diversify, that they have erected a statue. This is the only monument for a herbivore, for an agricultural pest in the whole world. The only one, the first one and the only one which has been erected. This is there in Alabama. There is a statue which has been erected for an agricultural pest which damages a crop. Why? Because it taught them that you should not rely on a single crop, but you have to diversify. So in appreciation, this has been established. Second group. So pollinator, for herbivores we are done with. Now we are coming to the second ecosystem functioning. Insects as pollinators. Many people would have seen the bee movie.
Yes.
Yeah. So a little bit skewed, but at least they had some things correct in it. So insects, there are a number of pollinators. Okay. If flowers are not pollinated, they will not set seeds. So it is very important for us also to grow fruit crops. In apple orchards, pollination is very important. If it is not pollinated, you are not going to get apples. And if you're going to kill by using insecticides, then there will not be any fruit set at all. Okay, it's so important. So you see here, you have bees, flies, wasps, butterflies, moths, all of them are pollinators. And based on which insect, they have a special relationship. From the time when flowering plants have appeared, insects are also there. They have evolved together. So that, you know, a particular smell is given by the flower, or the color of the flower is attractive to a certain group of insects. It may be a moth, it may be a fly, it may be a butterfly, or it may be a beetle even, some of them. Based on which insect it wants to attract, the flower also changes the shape, the color, the nectar, and the services it provides, so that it is able to be pollinated. So the flower is attracting the insect is getting some rewards, and it is giving back in turn pollination. So it is a mutualistic relationship that has developed over years, actually. So we are also, but because we know about this, and we are doing along landscapes of apple orchards or something, we are also utilizing their services. How? We are putting beehives in fields to increase the pollination. So these are beehives for the Apis species, that is the honeybees. And then you also have solitary bees, single bees. So the other ones, like for example, the paddy straw bundles, paper bundles, these are all useful for attracting the solitary bees. They don't give you honey, but they will be good pollinators. So this is how we are increasing the pollinator services inside the agricultural landscapes. In pollination system, I won't talk in detail about this, because if I talk, then you might not eat a fig again. But I would like to say that a fig, it cannot develop unless it is pollinated by a fig wasp. You know, have you all seen a fig tree?
Yes.
So you know, have you ever seen a fig flower?
No.
You cannot see a fig flower, because what you see as flower is what you see as the fruit, you know, it is a capsule. So this is actually a flower. What you see inside is the flowers. There are florets. A fig is made up of number of fruits inside, achenes they are called, and number of florets. So what you're seeing is just a receptacle which has flowers inside. And then there is a hole on top. This fig wasp will go inside, and then it pollinates, and that is how your pollination takes place and the fruit is developed. Okay? So that without this, you will not get figs. No fig in the world can develop without this fig wasp system. This is a very important. What I would like to say here is that some relationships with pollinators have developed so well that if it is not there, it cannot develop. Some orchids, they will attract only some flies. They will have a specific smell that will attract these flies, and then they will be in such a shape that it has to hit and it has to go inside and it will pollinate. The shape also will change. So this kind of systems have evolved over the years. Okay. Then coming to the third group, this is insect seed dispersers. Insect seed dispersion, why do you need seed dispersion in forests?
Spaced out.
So for example, if all the seeds fall under the tree, and where is the space to grow? So you have to take the seeds away from the parent tree, so that they'll get a better opportunity to grow, better places to grow. So seeds have to be dispersed. That's why, you know, you will get those thorny things which attach to your dresses, and when you walk it disperses. That is actually a type of seed disperser. When you get those thorny things on you, and then you tap it off somewhere, you're carrying the seeds and you're dispersing it somewhere. So ants and wasps are important seed dispersers. How do these plants get these ants and wasps to disperse their seeds? They have this kind of small substances attached, you know, you can see those white color things attached to the seed, called ileosome. They have some fatty substances and sugars in it, which are very attractive to the insect. But the seed is not, because it's very hard. So what the ant does, it will carry the seed to the nest, and then it will feed on that thing, or it will feed it to its young ones, and the seed will remain in the ant nest. And inside the ant nest, you know, it is a very healthy atmosphere, humidity is there, nutrients are there, and so the plant will germinate better. So that is how. And wasps also, if you see, they are also taking some seeds, and then the top is fed to the babies. and that's how the seeds are getting dispersed. So this is how insect seed dispersion happens. You can see, you know, that ant is carrying the seed. Underneath that, it's carrying it only for that white color thing. So the plant is tricking it. It is giving it something so that the seed can be carried away and it can get into a better atmosphere where it can germinate. So this is seed dispersion. Then the most important one is insect scavengers. You were telling that you don't like it. Many of you might have seen dung and then the beetle which are rolling dung, you know. They are all scavengers. You know, scavenging is a very bad part. You think it is dirty, but you know, it is very important. If your garbage is not removed, how will your neighborhood be?
Stinking.
Right? Same thing happens in nature. If some dead organism is not removed, if a decaying organism is not removed, if dung is not removed, what will happen? So, this is a very important, they are actually ecosystem engineers. Scavengers are ecosystem engineers. Not only do they use those unwanted decaying, dung and other things, they also return nutrient. They cycle the nutrient and return it to the soil. So, this is very important. We have a number of insects which do it. You know, in compost, you will get those beetle grubs. Then you have the blowflies which come on carcass. And which also comes on dung, and then you have the dung beetle, then you have the soldier fly. The black soldier fly nowadays is being used for composting. You have a lot of kitchen waste. Now they are multiplying this on the kitchen waste, and then these grubs are fed to poultry, and it has become an industry now. It is now, there is a whole industry which is dependent on the black soldier fly, which is this. The second one, the second line, the first one, those are the grubs. All your poultry food, your cat food, dog food have this. They are a part of it. They are dried, freeze dried, and then they are made into the food. They are incorporated because they are a source of protein. They are very good. And not only that, they also compost your kitchen waste. They are using the bad material to get good material. That is the fly, which is doing that. And then you also have carrion beetles, which feed on the carcasses, that is dead bodies of animals. You know, if a cow is dead and it's lying somewhere, or a dog is dead and dying, you know how much smell comes from it. But if you see within a week or 10 days, it's cleaned up. How does it happen? These blowflies develop on it as maggots, and they feed on it and they clean it up. So they are your cleaning crew. They are the most important part of the ecosystem functioning, actually. So I would like to tell a story, which I actually, when I went to Australia, this is what I learned there. So Australia originally did not have cattle. You know what is very famous in Australia? Which animal? Yeah. So kangaroo and other marsupials exist there. So their dung is sort of different, and there are 500 species of dung beetle which come on these marsupials. They are able to feed on it because this dung is a little bit fibrous and tight. And those dung, there are beetles which are specialized on that. But European settlers, just like they came and settled here, European settlers went to Australia and settled there, they occupied it. What did they do? They need food, they need beef, so they have introduced cattle there. So cattle farming has become the biggest farming activity in Australia after the European settlers went there. So you know how cattle dung is. Big pads, right?
It produces methane.
It's so big. So these dung beetles were not able to take care of those. What was happening in 1950-60, one Hungarian entomologist who went there, he noticed this fly menace. What was happening was a lot of flies were developing on that, and you just have to stand, you will be covered by hundreds and thousands of flies. So that menace was happening. Why? Because the dung was not being buried in. So usually the dung beetle, what it does is it buries the dung. It rolls it and then it buries it into the soil. That's how your cycling takes place. And the cattle dung, the local indigenous dung beetles were not able to manage that. So that is where the problem of flies started. So what he did was he studied. Now there is a huge project going on in Australia for millions of dollars. Millions of dollars for identifying dung beetles from different countries which are similar to Australia, like France, Europe and other countries. And they are importing it into Australia. This is the dung beetle rearing facility they have there. you know, these boxes you see, they have dung in it and the beetles are being reared there. What they will do is they'll import it first. It will be in a biosafety facility and then it will be seen whether there is any problem, and then the next generation will be distributed and they will be reared in situ in some places. And then with the help of farmers, since I assisted in releasing in one of the farmers' fields, the farmers are the stakeholders, the cattle farmers, and we'll have to go and release them. See, this I'm holding some of the beetles which was imported from France, you know, for millions of dollars. Why? Because we have played with the ecosystem. Human beings have played with the ecosystem and they think everything. Sentient beings, right? So we sentient beings think we can do anything. But nature knows what to do, and nature has its way of taking care of things. But when we play with things, this is what happens. Now we are spending millions of dollars to get dung beetles and introduce them into the farmers' fields. And it is very difficult to establish, because in Australia what happens is, as soon as June, July starts, summer sets in and everything becomes dry, totally dry, and you get dust storms. Actually, trees have been cut to establish these kind of pastures for the cattle. But it is not the natural ecosystem. Therefore, there is a lot of dust storms and tornadoes, and everything becomes totally dry. Dung beetles are not able to establish, and every year they have to release it back again. Every year they are releasing it back again. This is how the release system takes place. Then the next group is mine, biocontrol agents. So I work with biological control, you know. Arthashastra, you must have read about Arthashastra. They say your enemy is the enemy of your enemy is your friend.
Yes.
Right? So this is biological. This is the basis of biological control. Actually, what we are doing here is we are using the enemy of insects to manage insects. So what we do here is we have big facilities to rear these kind of good insects, what we think as good insects, which will manage the agriculture crop pests. There are two groups. One is the predator. Predator means, you know what, right?
Yes.
Like lion. So it will feed on another, it will prey on another insect and it will feed on it. That is a predator. It needs a number of insects in its lifetime to complete its life cycle. So that is a predator. See how it's feeding. I was talking about the extra oral digestion. They all poke. See, that is a small nymph, and what a big larva it has carried. It will walk for some distance along with it. It will just poke its siphon into it and it will be sucking the juices out. That is how. And then this is your ladybird beetle, which eats aphids. So these are all your good insects. We have rearing facilities for rearing this and then releasing it into the agricultural landscapes. Another group is the parasitoids. The parasitoids, what they do is, they will have only one host, that is one larva, and they develop inside this. They complete their whole life cycle inside that and then they emerge out. Unlike the predator, where a number of insects are being eaten, like for example, you need chicken today, you need chicken tomorrow, you need chicken the day after. Similarly, they need a lot of that, yeah. But these, they will just stay within one insect, they'll develop and then they will come out. But their numbers are more, so they will manage more. We do rearing of all these parasitoids and predators in the laboratories and then release them. Why? Because agricultural landscapes are not real. Real landscapes. That's why we need all this. We have to inundate them with more good insects so that they will keep the bad insects under control. Bad insects from our point of view, because they are eating the crop pests. So there are classical biological control agents, you know. California, the oranges are very famous, okay, citrus oranges, orange juice came from this, California, it's very famous. But that whole industry was affected because there was this white color, you might have seen in hibiscus plants, some white color insects, you know, it is covered by cushiony insects. So these cushiony scales, they are called, they were just devastating the orchards. So what they did from Australia, they introduced a ladybird beetle into California. And because of this, totally that insect was kept under control. No, thank you. So that because it was able to revive a whole dying industry, they have a plaque established for this insect. So it is called classical biological control. Similarly, there was a plant which was growing in the grazing lands, which was not good for the cattle, which was controlled by a beetle, and they have the tansy beetle. So they have a plaque also in commemoration of this. These are biocontrol agents that have changed the economy of humans, I would like to say. So the last category is insects as food or providers of food. You know, do you eat insects? Would you be able to?
No.
So this picture is from Nagaland. Okay, in Nagaland, this is the market will be flooded with insects. They eat all sorts of insects. Future is insects, I'm telling you. This is the cheapest protein available. Next to fish, this is the cheapest protein available. Already people are eating cricket powders. They are adding it onto their salads and everything. And anyway, but it provides food for a lot of people. Okay? It provides food for a lot of people where protein is rare. And then it also provides food for other animals like birds, anteaters and other things. So insects are food, and also how do they provide food? Tell me one thing you all have from insects. Yes, honey. Very good. So you get honey, okay? So that is provided by the bees, okay? So this, they are also providers of food. Then we other have beneficial insects also, which are being read. The honeybee, of course, and not just honey. Honeybees give you beeswax. Bee venom is used, you know, when you have knee pain, it is being used. And then propolis is the pollen mixed with honey. That is called propolis. It's supposed to increase your immunity and other things. And you have royal jelly, which is secreted by the bee, which is given only to the queen, the larvae which develops as queen. So this also is supposed to have very good properties, medicinal properties, and people are now harvesting this and taking it. And then you have the pollen. And then you also have lac insect. Have you heard of the lac insect? You know, it just encrusts the plant, and that earlier bangles of Hyderabad were made from lac. Nowadays it's not being made, but early bangles were made from lac. Actually, that is an insect, and that is melted down, and that is how the bangles were made in the early days. Nowadays we are not using it, but you know, when in Indian posts, when they seal something, they will use a brown color thing to seal it. That is lac. That comes. Then all your shellac, paints, everything come from lac. This is also being read. These are all called as beneficial insects. Then I would like to show, this is from one of my book chapters. This is just one small niche I am taking, just a rice field. Look at the complex interactions that are taking place in the rice field. Okay. First you have those planktons in the soil. You know rice, how it is grown? Have you seen rice fields, any of you? Okay, where is rice grown? How will the rice field be? So rice fields have a lot of water, right? It will have some water, standing water, and then the plant grows. So it will always have 1 foot of water standing in it. So there will be aquatic insects and there will be terrestrial insects. Aquatic is something that stays in the water. So this crop is very unique in all your agricultural crops, because all other crops will not be growing in water, but rice grows in water. Okay, so you will have both the aquatic insects and the terrestrial insects. So here first you will have planktons, then you will have the plankton feeders, then you will have the insects that feed on the plankton feeders. Then they come to the top crop, and in the crop you have, crops are primary producers. Then you have insects that feed on the primary producers. They are called the herbivores. Then you have the good and bad, good insects, that is predators and parasitoids, which feed on the herbivores. Then there are hyperparasitoids which feed on these parasitoids. So there are 4 trophic levels, if you see, just in one ecosystem. That is how complex your ecosystem is. And every part is very important. Human beings think that they just have to apply insecticide, manage the pest, everything is fine. But they are hitting a cascade effect. They are affecting the whole ecosystem. That is why we get into problems. That is why, you know, pests are not controlled. They there is outbreak and more spraying is done, more insecticides are used. You know, this is what happens. That is every ecosystem. What I, the take home is, it's very complex. Okay? Then you also have the ecosystem disservices. So tell me some of the negative impacts. One is you're all being creeped out by the insects. Then second is you have pests of agriculture crops, forests and stored products. Stored products means whatever you have at home. They all have insects, right? So that is all stored products. So they are all pests of stored products. Then you have vectors of diseases. Chikungunya, malaria, dengue, sleeping sickness. So many things come from this. Then you have venomous and allergic reactions. You know, there are two species of stinging ants in South America. If one stings, even in honeybees, actually in honeybees, when one stings you, they lose their life, actually. But when they leave their sting on you, okay, when they sting, they leave the sting, then they'll twist their body, they leave the sting there and then they'll move. So many of them lose their abdomen also along with that, their intestinal parts. But because that sting is there, that smell is there, all other honeybees will come and sting you. That is when you will go into anaphylactic shock. You know what you have to do for that? Take some green plant or something and rub on it. First remove the sting and then rub some green if you are stung, so that other bees will not come and attack you. So that they will not get that smell. Same way in ants also, there are two ants, they are called stinging ants. If one stings, then everything will sting you. And if 100 sting you, then you're gone.
Ma'am, if one stings us, so if other, why will others also come and sting us? Because they also,
they have a smell.
So why do they can also?
See, actually, insects are not thinking. They are reacting. Okay? They are not sentient. So their defense means they will all go out and attack. Yes, it's called altruistic behavior. Altruism is the term for it. Selfless, they will not think about themselves, they will just attack. So that is the behavior. Then you have nuisance insects, the flies. Yeah. So all these are the disservices. So recently you must also have heard of the insect numbers dwindling, right? So many people are talking about, yes, because of light pollution, about pesticides, loss of habitat, we are losing number of insect species. Many good species also, like Odonata, like dragonflies and damselflies, have become endangered. Butterflies have become endangered. So these, how to conserve them? So this is an urban landscape. So you can creep green roofs, you can create gardens on the top, you can have small eco ponds, you have indigenous growing trees, all these in your locality, you will be able to conserve the insects. So this is what I would like you to take home. Thank you. So now it's open for questions.